Good morning.
Good morning.
Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as we gather this morning for worship here at Pea Ridge United Methodist Church. No matter where you find yourself today, whether you are with us in person or worshiping with us online, we thank you for joining us today. A couple of announcements for us as we begin this day of worship, many of which you can find in your bulletin, and we invite you to take those home with you and peruse it and celebrate it and put it wherever you can see it, or just put it in a recycling basket. I don't know. But there are some great ways for you to stay connected. But one of the things we want to remind you is next week after worship, we will have a potluck to celebrate Alex and Sarah and the entire family as they prepare to depart from us and to move on to their new adventures and all that is before. So we want to remind you that all you need to bring is a side dish. Everything else is going to be taken care of for you. And so we hope that you can come and join us for that next Sunday after worship. Also want to remind you that on August the 16th at 11 a.m., we're going to start our midweek Bible studies back. Kind of conveniently, we're going to start it on the same day that school goes back. So we're all going to go back to school in a way and back to Bible studies. And so hope that you can be a part of that. We're going to start some evening ones later. We just haven't worked out those details yet, but this one's going to be at 11 a.m. in the Dorcas room. So hope that you can come and be a part of that starting on the 16th. It is a good day to worship. It is a holy day to worship. Whether you have the joy of Thaddeus to just say a lot of things and shout and chat, or whether you wish you were somewhere else. We are so glad you're here, and we ask for God to be with us as we come and give peace and presence to this moment. So as we begin this day of worship, let us stand and be called to worship and then join in our opening hymn together of "The Morning Has Broken." Trust in the Lord and do good.
May the Lord give strength.
O taste and see that the Lord is good.
God is our refuge and strength.
Let us sing. As we continue worship, I invite you to do so as we join our voices together to affirm that which we believe. So my friends, my brothers and sisters, what is it that you believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of a body, and a life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father.
Seeing as you are, invite our children to come forward for a time of children's moments. Hi. Oh, jeez. Look at him. Man. So I've got something today that I'm pretty sure you all have seen before. Y'all know what this is? A charging cord. What does it charge? What's that? Cell phones. What else could it charge? iPads. Yeah, y'all use this a lot, don't you? I use this every... I don't use this one, though, so much every day because it's too short because I need something a little longer. But
that's long.
Not a lot long for me because I can barely get to my outlets. So it's a pretty long cord, but you know, why do we need to charge things? So we can do things, right? And what happens if we don't charge it? They run out of energy, right? Yeah, and it's not good when we run out of battery, right? We get all mad and our phones die, our tablet dies, or even our computer dies. And then your sister gets grumpy, right? Noah gets grumpy too, and so does Thaddeus when their stuff dies. But I'm thinking about this cord. You know, sometimes we need a charge, and sometimes we got to charge with our faith to God. And you know, it's kind of like that one end. Hold that end. That one end might be God, and this end might be us. And right here, through all of that, is just us talking to God. Yeah. Sorry, didn't mean to scare you. I was just happy. But, you know, prayer and conversation and discussion and worship gives us energy and hope so that we can get through the day and get through it with love. So I want you to think about next time you see a charging cord, think of that. That's kind of like God charging us so that we can be the people God called us to be, okay? All right, so let's pray. Holy God, we give you thanks for the day. We give you thanks for everyone who's here and even the one who ran all over the place. Lord, we ask for you to be with us. And help us to be charged by you. In Christ we pray. Amen. All right, you guys can go on upstairs. And I'm going to see if I can get up.
Come on, baby, stay up.
Yeah.
I can't wait to stay up.
He was up before me this morning. On a Sunday morning, I get up at 5:30. I don't want to know what time he got up. I'm pretty sure he got up to watch the women's soccer game, but I'm not even sure that was the case. So if you want some of his energy, we could always use babysitters. But as we go to God in prayer today, we do so with a little bit of grief and a little bit of sadness in our heart as we remember the life of Carolyn Gerald, who passed away yesterday. We don't know of any arrangements at this time, and so we just ask you to be in prayer for the family as they mourn and grieve for her. If you have other prayer requests, things that you would like for us to know about, we would like to start cleaning up some of our prayer list and our prayer requests, knowing that some of them have been on since, you know, before Noah was born, or before Thaddeus was born at least. And so just help us out. If you have a prayer request, use those prayer cards that are in front of you. If you don't have a prayer card in front of you, you can always use the, you know, back of your offering sheets or things like that. Yes, Richard. Oh, my. Oh, wow. Yes, yes. So we'll remember Peggy as well. So let us go to God now in prayer. Holy God, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for your love, for your hope, and for your joy. Lord, we gather in your presence today, God, and it's easy for us to think about everything else that's on our agendas. It's easy to think about maybe things we would rather be doing, or where we would rather be, or anywhere else. It's easy, God, to come into this moment and think, well, we've done it before and we'll do it again. Why does it all matter? And it's easy, God, for us just to get so discouraged that we lose sight of why we are here. But yet, God, you have brought us together for a purpose this morning, to give you praise, to give you worship, to center our hope in you. Not in ourselves, not in our world, not our politics, not our ways things have always been or the way things we're afraid will go. But to center our hope in you. Help us to remember that today, God. Help me to remember that too. Help us to remember that in our words, our songs, how we care for one another. So that in all that we do, we give you glory. We lift up the prayers that have been mentioned in your presence, Lord. We ask for your comfort and your peace to come in each of those moments. For those who are grieving, for those who are worried about hospital visits, for those who are sick and struggling. Yes, even too, for us as a church. Help us, God. Help us to be faithful to you even now. Through Christ we pray. Amen. As we continue our worship, let us do so through the giving of our tithes and our offering.
Strength. You are the strength of my life. I lift my hands in total praise to
Before we continue, I want to apologize for being running all over the place. A certain three-year-old who will remain nameless decided to knock us offline for about 10 minutes. So I apologize. It's one of the struggles where we are right now of some of y'all don't realize I wear about 20 hats during a worship service. I apologize if it looks like I go from one thing to the next from time to time. It's just a matter of trying to love you all and where we are and where we're at. So I apologize if I offended anyone for not being up here or running around like a chicken without its head on. It's just kind of where we're at right now. So I invite you to hear this word from the Old Testament, from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 through 5. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And then from the book of Revelation, chapter 4, verse 9 through 11. And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to the one who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall before the one who is seated on the throne and worship the one who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, singing, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." The word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? Most holy and gracious God, Father, Lord, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for your love, for your grace, and for your joy amongst us. Lord, as we enter into this time of deep discipleship, we ask for you to open our hearts, our minds, and our ears so that we may be attentive to your voice speaking to us. Turn out the distraction of our day and our lives so that we may hear from you. Let us not think about those moments in this time. Help us to be faithful to you in this moment, to hear you. Lord, may I become less so that you may be more in this moment. And may the words of my heart and the meditation of my soul be pleasing to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. There's a question I ask every service, every worship, done so now for about 14 years. It's a simple question that perhaps we don't even think much of it as we hear it week after week after week. It's a question that forces us to think, forces us to reflect, forces us to remember. What is it that you believe? What is it that you believe as brothers and sisters in Christ? Words that may seem simple in nature, simply a pastor's tool to move us from one thing to the next in the order of worship and to offer a transition so that there is no such thing as empty air and silence. But questions that force us to pose upon the deep. Not simply giving us permission to recite words that we know by heart or have to remember sometimes when we stumble towards the end and we need to pull out page 882 or 881, the hymnal. A question that's not about the fact that we can remember some lines or stanzas. But a question that gets to us about what is it that we truly believe about God? What is it that we truly hold on to about God? What do we claim? And how do those beliefs affect who we are as a people and as a church? What is it that you believe? Perhaps it's a question that we don't give much thought to beyond just that moment of 30 seconds of recitation of a familiar creed and liturgy. Or maybe we don't even think much about it after Sunday morning worship when we head off to whatever it is that God has for us in this day and this week, but yet that question informs everything. Because what we believe, what we say to be true matters. It is what grounds us. It is what keeps us together. It is what gives us hope in dark and troubling times. Our beliefs about God inform everything we seek to do as people. And so we offer that question, what is it that you believe, as a way to reflect upon what it is that we actually claim about Christ and our faith, and how it calls us to live as the people of God. For it's one thing to say that you believe. We often say we believe is the same way that we say that we believe that WVU will actually get its head on straight one day. Or that we believe that life will be better tomorrow. We almost say that we believe in some way that we believe in this hope that we are not entirely sure what it is, but we think there is something out there. But yet Jesus says even the demons believe. When we think about belief, we're talking about what is deep in our core, what is deep in who we are, what matters to us. And so week after week, Sunday after Sunday, as a reflection upon remembrance of what it is that we believe, we say those words of a creed to confirm in our hearts, to remind us of who we are, and also to send us out in a world that is uncertain or unsure of itself so that we may know what it is we believe. Never the centuries and the years of the church, there are two creeds that have stood the test of time. Though there are others, these two have stood the test of time of the Apostles and the Nicene Creed. The Apostles' Creed of its formation was made for worship. It was made for our time together. Though there's that tradition that says, well, all 12 apostles were all together and came up with this statement of faith, the truth of the matter is it was probably dates around the 3rd or 4th century of the church. And the way of giving new believers something to reflect upon so that they may know what it is that they are claiming. It was a catechism for the early church where each of the three stanzas would come with a question. What is it that you believe about God the Father? What is it that you believe about God the Son? What is it that you believe about God the Spirit? And even two, what is it that you believe about the church? Candidates for baptism would study and reflect, and these words became the boundary markers of faith. They became the basic bedrock and the principles of our faith to remind us of what we hold in common together. Throughout the millennia and the centuries of the church, there has been much diversity of thought, much diversity in worship and reflection. But yet what we hold to be true through what we find in the Nicene Creed and also in the Apostles' Creed bounds us together in giving us the guardrails to say, this is apostolic teaching. This is what we hold to be true from the days of Christ to the early church, to the Middle Ages, to the Protestant Reformation, and even today. They are what we all hold together, and it's when we fall out of these statements that we run into heresy, false teachings, and going it our own way. So what is it that we believe about God? What is it that we hold to be true? That first statement, all three, if you notice one thing about the Apostles' Creed, we notice that it is Trinitarian in nature. Written in that way to remind us that God works in mysterious ways as God in three in one. Now, it doesn't mean that we have God the Father working over here, God the Son working over here, and God the Spirit over here, and that the three are like different departments in a store and that they never interact. Where the Father works, so does the Spirit and the Son. Where the Spirit works, so does the Son and the Father. And where there is the Son, there's the Father and the Spirit. They all work together, but yet they have unique functions that are important to understand. And so the creed grabs you from the first instance. I believe. I hold this to be true. I put my faith upon this statement. I claim this in my life. This is what guides me. This is what inspires me. This is what leads me when I reflect upon God. I believe in God. That very first line of I believe in God reminds us that we worship one who is bigger than ourselves. That in the beginning, when there was chaos, when there was a formless void, when there were bad drivers all over the world, there was God. God who created everything. God who is eternal, everlasting, beyond all things. And that mere statement, we remember that this world is not only for us. That we are not our own God. That we are not the only ones that matter in our own little kingdom. There's something bigger in this world, bigger than you, bigger than me, bigger than Pea Ridge United Methodist Church. And that is God. God whom we believe to be the Father. I believe in God the Father. Same word that Jesus used in his prayers to describe God. Same words that Paul used in Romans of I pray to my Abba Father. When we think about this phrase of I believe in God the Father, we are reminding ourselves of God's unconditional love. That love that a father shows their children is the same love that we see of God for us. Unconditional, caring, inspiring, strength, hope, character, discipline, and truth. God as Father offers us unconditional love and unconditional guidance and unconditional hope in our lives. It is who He is. And at the very core of His being, at the very core of God's essence, is love. Love that remains committed to each other. Love that remains committed to all of us. And over the decades and the years of the last few years, there's been conversations about whether or not we should use that word Father, claiming it to be offensive to people who have had abusive or distant relationships with their dads. I don't think we should remove it. I'm saying that as someone who never knew their dad and had a stepfather who was quite abusive. We shouldn't remove it. Because when I think about that as I believe in God the Father, I'm reminded of the fact that even when we feel like there is no one in this world for us, there's always God. Because even when no one else may be there, and even when everyone else abandons us, God the Father is still there, offering us unconditional love and giving us the ideal and the pattern for which we should love those who are around us with unconditional love as well. I believe in God, the Father Almighty. That word is powerful. It reminds us that God is the object of our worship. That God is the object of our praise because God is holy. God is powerful. God is just. And God is pure. And so when we say that God is almighty, we join with the heavenly courts from Revelation. When all the creatures of the world and all the creation of God and all the heavenly beings join in that voice together and say, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God, Father Almighty, blessed are you who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is you." We join in the heavenly courts to worship God, to praise his name, to remember that there is nothing bigger than our God, and that we rejoice in who our God is. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We like to think that creator is just another way of saying Father, but creator is what God does. It'd be like saying preaching is all that I am, or that's all there is to me, is that I'm a pastor. Pastoring is what I do. It's not who I am. But who I am informs how I preach. And it is out of who God is that informs how he creates. It was out of love that when there was nothing, when there was chaos, when there was a formless void, God looked upon it out of love and said, "Let there be light." And created this simply out of his voice for love. So that all of creation could worship and rejoice in his holy name, so that you and I can rejoice in what God has created, and so that you and I can be in relationship with God. God created this so that we may know him, love him, and worship him. Words are endless to describe the creation, and yet we often stop ourselves and start going into conversations here about how did God create? Did he bring out nails and hammers? Did he do it this way? Did he do it that way? Was it 6 literal days? Was it 6 metaphorical days? Was it this or what it that? Is that? None of that matters. Nor is it what Genesis is trying to give us. Much like the Apostles' Creed is made for worship, so is Genesis 1 and 2 made for worship. To give us a way to praise God and reflect upon God. Genesis gives us the why. God created out of nothing because he desired for there to be something in this world that would know him. The how of God did it and the what of God did it is immaterial. No matter how it happened, it was out of God's love. And so we rejoice in the creation of God. We look around it and we see that in the trees and you and me, and we say, it is, as God says, good. That one sentence is powerful. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so what in the world does that mean for us? Why does it matter? When we say that we believe in God, we remember there's hope. Life can get pretty discouraging right now. And when we remember that God is the one we claim, that we believe in, it gives us hope. Hope to face the dark voids in our lives and hope to face all that is before us. When we believe that God is love, we remember that we are too called to share that love with one another. Our beliefs can't just be things that stay in our head. They must be actions of our hearts. And so we love each other unconditionally. Not when we like each other or not when we are all on the same page, but we love each other, especially when we get on each other's nerves. We love, we encourage, and we stay with each other. That we say that God is Almighty reminds us of what worship is all about. We do not come for a show. We do not come to be entertained. We do not come to worship one person or two or three just simply because they stand before you and offer their gifts to God. We come together to worship God as one body with one voice, because of the almighty nature of God. So when we remember that we believe in God, we do not point our focus inward or sideways. It is always upward to God, to rejoice in what God has given us, and to rejoice in the joy of the Lord. And when we say that we believe that God created all this, then we take care of it. We love it for the next generation. Not say, well, this is my time and I'm going to just use it all up. But we care for what God has blessed us with. And we live with a mindset to leave this world a better place than what we found it. Our beliefs matter. And they inspire us to think about what it means to say what it is that we claim. Because we believe in God, let us live it out. To share unconditional love and worship. Because God has created all that we see and called it good. Will you pray with me? Most holy and gracious God, Father, Lord, we give you thanks for this day. Help us to reflect upon you, to claim our love, our hope, and to live our beliefs out in all that we do. Through Christ we pray. Amen. As we continue our worship, we do so as we gather in this time of liturgy and reflection as we prepare for the table. We come with a sense of prayer and a sense of hope to find ourselves at God's table, to be renewed and strengthened by his love so that we may share that love out. And so as we enter these words, I hope and I pray we do so with a sense of yearning for God in this moment. So my friends, Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with God and one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and each other. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for a joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us take some time for personal prayer and reflection. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God and amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks.
It is a right and good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and the recovering of the sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. And by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always, in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." Likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink of this, all of you. For this is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many. Drink of this as often as you gather in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as we offer ourselves as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. May they be for us the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now as forgiven and reconciled people, let us pray the prayer our Lord taught us to pray as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. It's the bread of life, broken for you and for many. Eat this in remembrance of him. It's the cup of grace poured out for you and for many, so that we may live out that which we claim about God in our lives. In a moment, we will share communion together. As you come forward, we invite you to take your hands, cup them together to receive it as an act of love and grace. And then you may dip it in the cup. Afterwards, if you wish, you may find some time to pray at the altar rail or simply go back to your pew. There's an offering basket up front to give to support the discretionary fund for this month. But as you come forward, remember, this is not my table. This is not Key Ridge United Methodist Church's table. This is not the United Methodist Church's table. This is God's table. And it doesn't matter who you are, what's going on in your life, or anything else, you are welcomed here because God thinks you matter. So I'm going to invite those who will be assisting me to come forward, and then we will share with everyone else. Come, taste and see that the Lord is good. Come.
Thank you.
God, let us leave from this meal with a hope for your love. In Christ we pray. Amen. Let us stand and sing. I love to tell the story. Let's sing the first and last verse. Place, go with this benediction. Go and share God's love. Go and remember that which you believe. Go and share it with each other, and go and live in hope. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.